Okay, well, let's get started. I want to talk today about the nature of dispositions. Last time we were talking about dispositions right at the end, in the context of Carnap's problem, because Carnap in testability and meaning says, in the end, we can really pose two questions. What does the sentence mean, and what is its method of verification? How do we find out whether it's true or false? And then he says, really, they have the same answer, because we should identify the meaning of a statement with its method of verification. That is to say, with ways in which we could confirm or disconfirm it. So his notion of verification is very broad, much weaker, you might say, than the notion that Ayer or originally Schlick had. But the idea, in a sense, is just to say, well, if I know what kinds of experiential situations would actually increase the probability I assign to this or decrease the probability I assign to this, then I've understood its meaning. So in that respect, it's actually very close to what Ayer at one point says, even though he then seems to forget about that when he actually frames the criteria officially. So let's take a look at how we might do this and how we might think about expressing some dispositional predicate, like soluble, for example, or malleable, or is a conductor, or something like that. Well, the difficulty is something that emerges very quickly, and it will help if we think in previous terms just about the connective if-then, because the most natural way to do this is to say, well, what does it mean to say that something is soluble? It's to say it dissolves if you put it in water. What does it mean to say that it's malleable? Well, it will bend if you apply pressure to it, for example. What does it mean to say that somebody is irascible? That they, if you do a wide variety of things, they get angry, and so forth. And so there are a lot of dispositional terms, some of them scientific, some of them ordinary, referring to people's character and so on, which seem to have this underlying if-then structure. But now, what do we do with this connective if-then? So far, we've been talking about, with our criteria of adequacy, for example, not, saying that, look, in the end, it better emerge that S is meaningful if and only if not S is meaningful, that S and N should be meaningful only if both S and N are meaningful, that S or N should be meaningful only if both S and N are meaningful, and so on. And presumably, we'd want to say if S then N should be meaningful only if both S and N are meaningful. But how does that meaning actually get computed? Let's think back to Frege, who characterizes a kind of ideal model language and says that in such a language, all expressions should be, or all contexts, we might say, should be extensional, in the sense that if you substitute something with the same reference, you should get precisely the same truth value. And it turns out that things like belief, saying that, knowing that, and so on, are problems from that point of view, right? They seem to be intentional contexts rather than extensional contexts. Well, what do we say about if then? Suppose we think that we want something that represents a conditional statement like if then, but in an extensional language, how would we do it? Well, let's fill in the slots here. If A, then B, let's say. And now we can think, well, all right, if we want that to be an extensional context, it has to be a truth function of some kind. So we should be able to specify the truth values of A and B, and then get out of that a truth value for if A, then B. So let's think about how we might do it. Suppose both A and B are true. Well, we have to specify what the truth value is there. So as A is true and B is false. A might be false while B is true. Finally, both might be false. So to specify this as a truth function and get it to be a fully extensional context, we had better be able to fill in a determinate truth value for each of those four. Now, some of these you might think aren't so hard. Let's take a concrete example. There was a bathroom on campus where one of the soap dispensers was, I guess, partially clogged, but not entirely clogged. So if you pressed the thing to get some soap, it would squirt right out at you. Okay? So suppose somebody walks into the bathroom, and having squirted this all over myself, I say, don't use that dispenser. If you use it, you'll get soap all over you. Okay? Well, that's an if-then statement. Now, suppose the person walks up and ignores me and hits the dispenser, and they do get soap all over. Was my statement true or false?
True.
Yeah, you might think it anyway. It's true. So it's very plausible to put a T there. Suppose they ignore me, they hit the dispenser, and it works fine for them. Then what was my statement?
False.
But now, what if they take my advice and so they don't use that dispenser? Okay, so A is false. If you use that dispenser, you get soap all over you. Aha, they don't use the dispenser. Now, actually, in this possibility, they don't use the dispenser, but they get soap all over them anyway. So, you know, they say, oh, thanks. They go over to the next one. The same thing is true in the next one. They hit it. Soap all over them. Now, what did we say about my statement? That's hard, a little hard to say. You might think, well, nothing's happened to contradict it. Might be true. Suppose they take my advice, they don't use it, so they don't get soap all over themselves, they go to the other dispenser. Works fine. Now, the problem is, in these cases, it's not really tested, right? And so it's hard to say what happens. Suppose, actually, I don't have to say suppose. My daughter used to have a sign on her bedroom door at home that said, trespassers will be shot. Survivors will be shot again. Okay. Now suppose indeed that intimidates everyone, so no one is a trespasser. Was the statement true or false? Nobody ever trespasses. They're afraid of the sign.
True.
Ah, true. Actually, yeah, you might say, well, come on, it was pretty effective, right? On the other hand, is it true that she would have shot somebody who went into her room? No, she didn't even have a gun. Okay, thank heaven. So it would turn out that, yeah, it's sort of hard to say here. You might say, well, gosh, the whole idea here is that we've got a sort of trial, you might say. Is this true or false? Well, let's try out A and see whether B happens. And if we never try it, it's hard to determine. Now, one of the things we typically say in standard logic is that, well, in these cases, nothing's happened to contradict it. So take the weakest of the possible connectives that seems like a plausible candidate. The weakest of those connectives would just declare this true in both cases. And that's the way people standardly define the truth functional connective that's often symbolized this way, a horseshoe B. And it's actually impossible to do better than that if we start thinking about this as some kind of truth function. After all, what else could we do? We've only got those possibilities. We could put truth in both places. We could put truth in falsehood, or falsehood in truth, or falsehood in falsehood. But actually, none of those others makes any sense at all. Suppose we use this one. Well, then we'd be saying, haha, true, false. In other words, this would be true if and only if B was true. So this would make if A then B just equivalent to B. But obviously that's ridiculous, right? Saying if you use this dispenser you'll get soap all over you is clearly not equivalent to saying, ha ha, you'll get soap all over you no matter what. What about this option? Well, if we use that option, we'd then be saying, aha, it's true only in the first and last case. So that's a way of saying, either they're both true or they're both false. But again, that's not what the if-then statement means. In fact, that might be closer to what an if-and-only-if statement means. So that's not right. That really implies some sort of equivalence between them. What if we made both false? Well, then we'd be saying true, false, false, false. We'd be saying A and B, right? So that would make this equivalent to and. And so plainly, we can't do any of those. Consequently, if we're to call this any kind of truth function at all, that's our only choice. Now, you might think that if-then in English really does mean that, and there are philosophers around, even today, that defend that. Most people think that's not quite right, for reasons that are going to emerge. why might you think that's not quite right? That if-then expresses something stronger?
Because there isn't really much implication between A and B.
That's right. It's a very weak connection between A and B, right? It's just saying, look, it's not the case that A and not B, really. And that's a very weak sort of link. To show you how weak, there are things known as the paradoxes of material implication. which is what this connective is often referred to, material implication, which is kind of unfortunate because it's not really a kind of implication at all. But why? Well, here's one thing that seems odd about it. If B is true, well, that implies that sense of if A, then B. After all, if B is true, then it's one of these two things that are true, and if A, then B is true in both of those cases. So that's just going to follow from the truth of B. So you're in the room right now. Yay. So I can say if anything at all in the world, you're in the room right now. Right? And it doesn't have to be a true statement. It could be anything. If there are round squares, you're in the room right now. If the Russians have incinerated Austin with a nuclear weapon, you're in the room right now, etc. That seems weird. Now, it's not exactly, I mean, it's not the kind of thing that you maybe say, whoa, that's ridiculous. But at the very least, that seems troubling. And here's something that also seems troubling. It will also be the case that not A implies if A, then B. So you are not in Cleveland. If you're in Cleveland, you'll be hit by a bus. That doesn't feel like that should follow. So something weird is going on here. Now, all that's really just background, because we get to the point of thinking about disposition terms in Carnap's language. And keep in mind, the idea is we want to take these dispositions and explain how they can be understood in terms of experience. We want to relate them, define them ultimately in terms of observation. So we have something like soluble. X is soluble. Well, we might think, okay, that's going to be equivalent to some kind of statement. And what? What does it mean to be soluble? Water soluble, we'll assume. Is the chalk soluble? Gosh, is my shirt soluble?
No.
Good. It has been placed in water. It did not dissolve, okay? It would have been a real bummer if it had. So, this hasn't been placed in water, and we'll come back to that example. But you might think, look, yeah, it dissolves if it's placed in water, right? So X is soluble if and only if, now we get a sort of conditional. If X is placed in water, X dissolves. And so you might think, aha, this is the general form. We've got a disposition term. And so you might think the general idea is this. The disposition term applies to X if and only if, well, if X meets some kind of condition, then there's some kind of event that follows. Actually, often people use M for this to say, then there's some kind of manifestation of the disposition. Well, okay, so let's suppose we are thinking about how to introduce disposition terms into our observational language. We want, as Carnap does, to define them in observational terms. And being placed in water, we think, well, that's kind of observational, sure. You know, I drop this in water, right there. I can maybe just define in observational terms what it means to be placed in water. And to dissolve, well, I can imagine what it's like to see something dissolve. I put the sugar in the tea, let's say, and I stir it up, and there it dissolves. So I can, let's say, characterize that in observation terms. So then I say, good, I can characterize solubility. If X is placed in water, X dissolves. Now, how does that work as a characterization of solubility in observational terms? Yeah, it's not great. Why not?
No. Can you repeat the question?
Oh, okay. Yeah. See, sometimes I think you're sitting there shaking your head with deep insight. In fact, you're shaking your head thinking, I have no idea what he's talking about. But good. What I mean is this. We've got a sort of definition of solubility, a disposition term, in what seem to be observation terms. At least we can think, yeah, being placed in water, let's assume we can characterize that observationally. And the same thing with dissolving. I put some some sugar in some tea. I shake it up or I stir it. Okay, I see that it dissolves. I put some sand in the tea. I stir it up. I see that it does not dissolve. And so I think, yeah, I can characterize dissolving in observational terms. Same with this. So now I say, aha, so then I can give you an observational definition of solubility. If you place the thing in water, it dissolves. And so we can say X is soluble, has the disposition term, if and only if, well, what? If you place it in water, if you fulfill a certain condition, whatever that is, then the disposition is manifested. Then, in this case, it actually does dissolve. So I say that person is irascible. And what does that mean? Well, it means that if you do something to annoy that person gets angry. Okay? Malleable. If you apply pressure to this thing, it bends. What are some other disposition terms? Friendly. If you greet this person, they respond kindly, let's say. And so forth and so on. Now, actually specifying the right condition, the right manifestation, that's complicated. But you might think that's the general strategy. Okay, so Carnap thinks about that, and at first glance says, yay, I can reduce disposition terms. But then, something funny happens. Think about the history of this piece of chalk. It was formed in a chalk factory. And it got shipped to the University of Texas. It ended up in this classroom. Here I am holding it in my hand right now. Okay, it's a moment of greatness. It's being immortalized on video. Okay, it appears in a movie. It'll probably appear in a bunch of movies before it totally gets exhausted. But eventually it will really get used up by being, you know, written with. Now assume that all throughout its life history, it's never placed in water. Intuitively, is this soluble? Well, by this definition it is, right? Because it turns out that, hey, if not A, then if A, then B, by this criterion. And so if it's never placed in water, it turns out that it counts as soluble automatically. Okay, so we've got a funny thing here. We've got a test for solubility that involves being placed in water. But if something's never placed in water, it turns out automatically to be soluble. Yeah?
I use that intuitively.
Okay, good. Intuitively, is this chalk soluble?
Yeah.
Really? You think chalk's soluble?
I think so.
If I took this into... See, it'll ruin my example if I put this piece of chalk under the water.
You could use water to get chalk off the board a lot more easily.
So all right, let me go back to my shirt then. Is my shirt soluble? No. Now, in this case, you can say, well, that's fine. I understand that because it has been placed in water and it did not dissolve. Right? So we say the shirt is soluble if and only if it's placed in water, then it dissolves. It has been placed in water. It did not dissolve, so that's false. So it's false that it's soluble. And that all works very nicely. Suppose I think about the sugar. Is the sugar soluble? I place it in water, stir it around. It dissolves. I say, aha, it was placed in water. It did dissolve. So good. That conditional is true, so it is soluble. But now I take something never placed in water. And we are in some disagreement about whether chalk is soluble, so let's take a different kind of example. My Apple Watch. I have not placed my Apple Watch in water, and I hope I never do, because very bad things will happen if I place it in water. So let's assume that I succeed in this endeavor to keep it away from water, and that the Apple Watch never actually gets placed in water. Is the Apple Watch soluble? Well, if we say something's soluble if and only if it's placed in water, it dissolves. It's never placed in water. Therefore, this condition is true. So it turns out the Apple Watch is soluble. But that's not why I don't want to put it in water, right? It's not going to dissolve if I put it in water. It's rather that if I put it in water, it will not work anymore. But it's not going to dissolve. So intuitively, it seems like the Apple Watch is not soluble. And yet, it looks like this definition forces us to count it as soluble. So the problem here really is, what if not CX? That is to say, what if the condition is never fulfilled? What if the Apple Watch is never placed in water? Are you irascible? Well, suppose nobody ever really annoys you. Then, are you irascible? What would happen if somebody did? Now, that's odd because people routinely do get annoyed, so it's hard to imagine somebody living for very long without getting annoyed. But what are some dispositions where it would be actually very hard to tell whether the average person has that disposition or not, because they just don't face that situation? Well, here's an example. How would you react under fire? And I really mean literally under fire. In Marine Corps basic training, people have to crawl on their bellies under barbed wire and through obstacles and so on, while it used to be real live fire was going overhead. Now they simulate this, but they make it sound and look as if bullets are flying over your head, okay, as you go through here. What do people do under those circumstances? What would you do if you were there crawling across a field under things with bullets whizzing over your head? Now, most of us never face that situation. And so you don't know, right? Yeah.
Okay, so like if, since we never face that situation, we might have a good idea of how we would behave. But then like people for like a very seasoned like military recruiter, would they be like, they see like certain characteristics and like they see how they play out because like past experiences, they might have better, they might understand a better idea of like, given these conditions, how might they? So it seems like...
All right, there might be things that correlate with this. And so we might think, there's something about bravery. We think about your bravery in other kinds of situations. And so you might think there's a stable character trait of courage, and this is one way it could be manifested, but there might be many ways. On the other hand, what really happens in these situations is that a certain number of people absolutely freak out. And this tends to be done early in basic training, and the people who freak out are sent home. They're not given a dishonorable discharge or anything like that. It's just like, yeah, you have this immediate reaction that you can't control. Rather than trying to overcome that, go home and do something else. Okay? And the idea is, really, why do they do that? Well, because in a live situation where real people are shooting at you, trying to kill you, who knows how you're going to react? It's very important that you react in a certain kind of way. And some of that can be trained into people, but some of that is just a sort of disposition that's only revealed in those kinds of extreme situations. So they put you in a kind of extreme situation to find out. Most of us, we might read about battle situations and think, how would I have reacted in those circumstances? And we have no idea, because we're never placed in a circumstance remotely like that. So I might say, well, there's a kind of courage that's involved in that kind of extreme life-threatening situation. What would you do? You might say, intuitively speaking, I have no idea, because I've never been placed in that situation. I don't know how I would respond. But it would be very strange to say, oh, would I be truly courageous under fire in that situation? Sure. How can you be so sure? I've never faced such a situation. Right? So I have the disposition. As long as not C, I'm cool. So you want to be really brave in battle, extreme situations? Just stay out of battle. Okay. And it seems like, wait, no, that's something, that things have gone really wrong. Yeah.
So earlier with the talk, you were reading not C of X as the condition is never fulfilled. And
well, yeah, what I really should be doing is putting in times. So what Carnap does is say, okay, really this is a question of times. So I should be saying X has the disposition at T if and only if, or actually I guess I should say, well, what should I say here? Actually, this is a subtle question. What he says is something like this. X has the disposition if, and only if, for all times T, if the condition is met at T, then the disposition will be manifested at T. But the thing that's strange about that is that dispositions come and go, right? You might be very quick-witted at a certain time in your life. And then later, when you get old, you might be rather forgetful and not very quick-witted at all. Being quick-witted is a kind of disposition that can come and go. The same thing is true with your ability to speak a foreign language. You might not have that disposition to speak that foreign language or that ability at all, but then you learn the language and you do, but eventually you might forget it. And so these things can come and go with times as well. So really, we should probably be saying you have the disposition at time t. Now, is it just that if this at that time, then this at that time? That would be a way of saying, really, we ought to be saying for all times t, you have the disposition at t if and only if, well, if you meet the condition at t, then you show the manifestation at t. So that would be another way of doing it. You might also think, well, really, it's a matter of having the disposition at a time if there's some larger time around that time. Not all times in the universe, but all times within a certain interval of that you show this. So we can think about the temporal sensitivity of this in different ways. I mean, I would think the more common way to do, or the more plausible way to do, would be to do that, and say it's not really just that you manifest that at T, if that, but that within a certain region of time around that, you have that characteristic. In any case, you're right, this is going to have to be sensitive to times. And so, really, we should say either this as Carnap does, or this, or maybe, I guess what I'm suggesting is something like, for any T, X has the disposition of T, if and only if, for any T prime, within a certain interval, so I'll just not specify what that is, but I'll just say, as long as T prime relates to T in the right sort of way, then, if X is placed in the condition of T prime, then X shows the manifestation of T prime. Need one more. Okay. Anyway, if this makes sense to you, that's awesome. If it makes no sense to you, if you're looking there thinking, what? Don't worry about it, okay? It's just like, what does it mean? What is a disposition you now have as a college student that you did not have yet when you were young? I need something that's going to vary with time.
Where did R come from?
Where did R come from? Oh, it's just expressing that interval. So the idea is we want, let's say, to focus on the time t here, and I want some time that is within a certain interval, right? So I don't want to just say, you show the manifestation here, but say there's some region around there. And so t prime is somewhere, you know, within that interval, say. I could say, I suppose, t, the absolute value of t prime minus t, you know, is less than n, or something like that. So, but see, every time I do this, every time I write a symbol down, I have a feeling that two or three people say, and then more than a dozen people say, so this is a losing battle. But anyway, if that helps, great. Anyway, forget the time business for now, and just think about what it is to be soluble. Let's assume that's not a disposition. It really changes particularly over time, so that we don't have to worry about the times. And then we can say, look, if something is not placed in water, well, here, if it's never placed in water, if that's our one, here, if it's not being placed in water at that time, that's especially bad, because as long as the sugar is still in the spoon and hasn't been placed in the water yet, it counts as soluble. Well, that's fine for the sugar. It's not so fine for the sand. And here, we would have to sort of think about a certain region of time around that. Anyway, that's why I said never placed in water. That's what we'd have to say if we say this, as Carnap and Hempel actually do. Yeah?
How would we deal with the fact that if we defined insolubility in the like same way, things would also be insoluble, right?
If water. Very nice. What does it mean to be insoluble? It's really plausible to say, well, it's insoluble if you were to place it in water, it would not dissolve. And then anything that hadn't been put in water and was never put in water, let's say, would count as both soluble and insoluble. And that, too, is really weird, right? So this does face us with an interesting puzzle. And that's actually a really nice way of seeing the puzzle. What about insolubility? And in general, you might say the opposite of a disposition term. A lot of disposition terms do come with opposites. You know, the wire might be live or it might be dead. This thing might be malleable or it might be, what would the opposite of that be? Rigid. Something might be fragile or it might be
sturdy.
Somebody might be irascible, that is prone to anger, or somebody might be gentle. So lots of these things do come with opposites that have this same character. And if we think, the negation would go there, the manifestation here is not getting angry, or not dissolving, or not bending, etc., etc., then it does look like we get things being both, having both the disposition term and its opposite in these cases, which is terrible. So what can we do? Well, here's Carnap's solution. Carnap says, look, we need some way of introducing these terms if we're to really link them to observation, but we can't do it in the way we'd really like to do it. So how do we do it? Carnap says we do it by means of reduction sentences. So in short, I can't say the thing has the disposition if and only if you were to have the condition fulfilled, it would show the manifestation. Instead, what I have to do is say, aha, so let's see. Go back to this. You might think, go back to my soap dispenser, in fact. I say, if you use the dispenser, you'll get soap all over you. Well, the test condition is where you do use the dispenser. But suppose you don't use the dispenser. We might think, then I simply don't know. So here would be a way of thinking about it. Forget the last two lines of the table. All we're really sure about is what happens if the test condition is fulfilled, right? So we might think, aha, here's the way to do it. If the condition is fulfilled, then the thing is soluble, so it manifests the disposition if and only if, well, the manifestation occurs. So what would this mean with solubility? It would mean if you place it in water, in water, then X is soluble if and only if X dissolves. Now notice what that's going to do. That is only a partial definition of dx, because we've got dx here as a function of cx and mx, let's say, and try to fill in the table. Well, here's how it will go. Suppose cx and mx are both true. What is dx?
True.
True, that's right. Because it says if cx, well good, cx is true, then dx if and only if mx. But mx is true, so dx is true. In other words, you place this in water, and it does dissolve, so it is soluble, according to this partial definition. What if we place it in water and it does not dissolve? Then it's false. Because we say if you place it in water, then it is soluble if and only if it dissolves. It doesn't dissolve, so it is not soluble. False. What about the other two cases here? Suppose I don't place it in water. So this is false. Now I have no idea.
It could be true or false, right?
It could be true or false. So in short, it is just not defined in these cases. We only get a partial definition. We get that much characterized, but we don't have the rest. Okay? So this gives us what Carnap refers to, indeed, as a partial definition.
For the last one, it can't be either true or false, right?
Yes, that's right. So it's really, yeah, it could be true or false. We
can't tell. And then the last one can't be either. Wait, why is it undefined?
Oh, but, well, if cx is false, then this is true no matter what dx and mx are. Mm-hmm. So from the fact that dx is, or rather mx is false, let's say,
then
we can infer nothing.
Yeah.
It's kind of like saying if we are on the moon, then you will get an A in the course, if and only if you can jump higher than 10 feet.
Why can't the third row be true?
Why can't it? Well, it could be true. It's just not guaranteed to be true. Okay? Because this is saying if CX, then this relationship holds. But what if not CX? Oh, then we've said nothing.
Okay, I see.
Just like my condition for getting an A in the course on the moon is irrelevant on Earth. Gives us no information about what it takes to get an A on Earth. Okay, now, Carnap in the end says, all right, that's the best we can do. So we can link these things to observation, but we can't define them explicitly. We can't define them precisely. We can only give these partial characterizations based on these reduction sentences. And now Hempel shows along the way that actually this turns out to be weirder than you might think, because it turns out that it will take often more than one of these reduction sentences to characterize a disposition term. Now, in the case of solubility, it's not really complicated. What do you do to test for solubility? Put something in water, right? But what about intelligence? You might think intelligence is a disposition term, but how do you test for intelligence? Well, maybe if we could, well, I'm not sure, because suppose, yeah, one sign of intelligence, you might say, might be performing well on a standardized test. Another manifestation of intelligence might be speaking intelligently, or writing intelligently, or understanding complex ideas, or being able to perform complex tasks, and so forth. So there might be lots of different ones, and it's hard to see how we could write that down. You might think, ah, if we give you a standardized test, or ask you to speak, or ask you to write, or observe you performing a complex task, or et cetera, then, but now, what exactly do I do for saying what happens on the other side? I don't want to say if I ask you to perform a complex task, you then get a good score on a test or something. And so it looks like the most plausible thing to say in these cases is you need several reduction sentences. So we might think, ah, yes, we need to say, you know, like, if, gosh, in condition one, it's the case that, okay, you have the disposition if and only if manifestation one occurs. And then in condition two, you have that if you have the disposition. Well, you have the disposition if and only if manifestation 2 occurs, and so on. Sort of like we give you the standardized test, and you are intelligent if and only if you perform well. So already, actually, that's already not right, right? Because there are all sorts of additional conditions. Yeah?
I was just going to ask, what does do with, like, how we define intelligence in terms of, like, being binary mixed versus not, because like solubility is just like it's soluble or it's not like halfway, but like
right.
We don't just say people are like smart or stupid, like there's
a spectrum. Okay, good. You're convincing me intelligence is a really bad thing. But you're right. Some of these things are matters of degree and some of them are just off and on. So we've got something like like solubility, that really is just an off and on.
Solubility is definitely a matter of degree.
Actually, it is a matter of degree,
yeah.
You're right.
I mean, it depends on like the temperature of the
water. It depends on the temperature of water, how much agitation it takes.
Yeah, there's like equations they govern.
No, you're right. So solubility is already a matter of degree, and we don't have anything about degree here. Yeah, most things about character, not just intelligence, but courage, you might think, is a matter of degree. The same thing true with irascibility. You know, how easy is it to piss somebody off? Some people are really easy to piss off. Some people are very difficult to piss off. And then there are all sorts of degrees in the middle. So can we think of one that's a really good example of one that's just, no, it's really on-off. Because notice all of these presuppose an on-off structure. They don't give us degrees. So that already should make us think, wait a minute, something's going wrong. Yeah.
Well, it seems like solubility may have degrees, but whether something is soluble or not is like, it's one or the other. And like the condition may differ, so like if a certain object in any kind of like liquid will never ever dissolve,
right,
then that is just simply not soluble.
Well, that's true. We might say, look, yeah, to no degree is this soluble, right? And so it seems as if we could still characterize something like that. Maybe somebody, could there be an extreme off-on for irascibility? Maybe there's somebody who just doesn't get angry no matter what. A little hard to imagine. Maybe there's somebody who gets angry no matter what. That's easier for me to imagine. So maybe we can get on-off things by just going to an extreme, right? And that might be it. Well, anyway, you're now convincing me this example isn't nearly as interesting as I thought, but the point was going to be to say, if we combine these two things, and we say, well, what happens if C1 and C2... then we get, well, dx if and only if m1x and dx if and only if m2x. Some connection emerging between the C's and the M's. And this is part of Hempel's point in his article to say, it's going to turn out that things follow about the relationship of the conditions of the manifestations, where the D term actually can just drop out. And when that happens, you actually get something rather strange. You can get things that seem to be analytic actually having synthetic consequences, for example. But anyway, we're almost out of time, so I don't really want to run through that in detail. Let me just go back to our table here and think there's another way of dealing with this. So let's look at what Ryle does. I've been saying a definition of solubility might be if you place it in water, it dissolves. But actually, Ryle says that's not the right way to understand it. We should instead say if you were to place it in water, then it would dissolve. Okay? So here's the pattern. X is soluble if and only if you were to place X in water, X would dissolve. And so that's a counterfactual condition, okay? Counterfactual because the assumption is here, it hasn't yet been placed in water. If you were to place the chalk in water, would it dissolve? That's what would determine solubility. And this is something that could be true or false, even if I haven't placed it in water, because we think about what would happen, not what already has happened, or what will at some point happen. Okay? So intuitively speaking, it seems like that does a much better job. As Ryle himself puts it, we say, yeah, to say that a lump of sugar is soluble is to say that it would dissolve if submerged anywhere at any time in any parcel of water. To say that this sleeper knows French is to say that if, for example, he's ever addressed in French or shown any French newspaper, he responds pertinently in French, acts appropriately, or translates it correctly into his own tongue. Now, it says, of course, that's too precise and so forth, but nevertheless, that's the general idea. If you were to be placed in this condition, you would exhibit the manifestation. There are different ways in which people symbolize that, and I guess one of the common ways is introduced by David Lewis much later, and it's to say it's not that kind of conditional, it's instead this kind of conditional, a box with an arrow. Okay? If the condition were to be fulfilled, then it would be the case. So we might think a counterfactual way of understanding the disposition terms is, if not it is, but if X were placed in water, X not dissolves, but would dissolve. And then we have that understanding. Okay, so it has the disposition, if and only if. If it were placed in that condition, it would exhibit that manifestation. Now, how is that any different? Well, first of all, it's the kind of thing that can be true or false, independently of the truth or falsehood of this. So first really significant consequence is that we don't have an extensional context anymore. We have an intentional context. We can now substitute things with the same truth value and get different truth values in this. So one important difference here is this is intentional. We cannot substitute things with the same truth value and preserve truth. Let's say the thing has not been placed in water. It has also not been put on the moon. I cannot substitute put on the moon for placed in water and get the same answer. If this were placed in water, it would dissolve. If this were placed on the moon, it would dissolve. Different truth values. Okay? Even though it's not placed in water, it's not put on the moon, so those antecedents have the same truth value, but the counterfactual conditionals have very different truth values. What other differences does this make? Well, now, those paradoxes of implication don't hold. That is to say, B no longer implies if A were the case, then B would be the case. We're in this room, but if the building were to catch fire, would we be in this room? No. We'd run. Okay. Also, not A does not any longer imply if A were the case, then B were the case. The mere fact that the building is not on fire does not mean that if the building were to catch on fire, we would all stay here and burn to our deaths. Okay, what else? Well, actually, there are other important differences here. And one of the main ones is that strengthening of the antecedent fails. Oops. So, what do I mean by that? Well, if A, then B does imply that if A and C, then B. If we understand it in those truth functional terms. However, we cannot say if A were the case, then B were the case. Ah, it follows that if A were the case and C were the case, then B would be the case. So, if I were to place this in water, it would dissolve. If I were to place it in water and very, very rapidly freeze the water, it would dissolve. That doesn't follow, okay? And so this has a more complicated structure. And people really hadn't even noticed that problem with the earlier characterization, but that's really important. Or let's take the intelligence thing. Let's say if I were to put you in a situation where you had to perform a complex task, you would do it. If I were to put you in a situation where you had to perform a complex task and did my most to distract you through jumping about and putting you in physical pain, right? So I say, yes, we're going to give you an IQ test, but there are two problems. One is, it's going to be while the dentist is drilling your tooth without anesthesia. And in the other case, I'm going to be kind of doing karaoke of Def Leppard songs, okay? Your performance is going to be different, right? And so we can't just add any condition and have this maintained. So that suggests that actually the logic of these disposition terms is very much more complicated than Carnap thought. Well, next week we're going to turn to the philosophy of W.V. Quine, an empiricist who tries to redefine empiricism and abandon logical empiricism for something much more similar to pragmatism.